Finally tonight, a new and unconventional work of poetry from one of our own. Gwen has our latest conversation for the NewsHour bookshelf.
You know Jeffrey Brown as NewsHour's jack of all trades, who provides a window into breaking news as well as books, culture, and poetry. It turns out Jeff writes poetry too, and his first collection is out. Aptly, it is called The News Poetry, and Jeff joins me now.
Oddly enough, sitting on this side of the table.
Well, Jeffrey, you know, anyone who follows your work thinks of you possibly as a hard-bitten newsman, not someone who sees the world this way. I didn't even know you were writing a book of poetry. Why did you decide to do it?
You know what? I am a hard-bitten news guy. I mean, that's our world, right? Mm-hmm. We go out into the world, we see things, we tell stories, we meet people. But there's a side of me that loves literature, that loves poetry, that loves history, that loves ideas, that loves music. It comes out, I hope, on the program as well. I started writing a long time ago. I wrote at different times during my life. I would pick up snippets from along the way. I started realizing that I wanted to go back and look at stories that I had done and sort of rethink them, reimagine them, tell them in a different voice with different words. And it was fun for me. It was interesting to do.
Were you thinking of these stories through a poet's eye at the time, or was it looking back at it?
It was looking back. No, huh. When I'm doing it the way you and I, we're news people, right?
Right.
So we're telling stories, but I would sometimes hear things. And one of the things that was most interesting for me in writing the poems was a memory of something that had happened that hit me at the time or that stayed with me, you know, that stayed there. I might have written down the phrase. In some cases, I went back and looked at the transcripts. I went online and looked at the transcripts of old stories I had done because it was partly there and I wanted to find that voice again.
When you did that, did you discover that Richard Avedon was right when he told you the camera always lies?
Yeah, it's not so much that it lies. I mean, you know, I use that quote, and I use quotes from people, and Richard Avedon said to me,
the photographer,
he said, and we did an interview late at night in the Metropolitan Museum, surrounded by his grand portraits. And we were talking because this is a subject that fascinates me as it does with him. Anybody who has a camera in front of them, what does the camera tell you? Well, it tells you a truth, but it doesn't tell you the whole truth.
Only a truth.
A truth.
I'm going to ask you to read some of your writing because I took me places I didn't know you'd been. One poem you write is when you were in Haiti and you went there on a reporting trip after the earthquake.
After the earthquake, but cholera had broken out. Things were very desperate. I went to a slum in Port-au-Prince and then I went to a small village where people were dying in the Central Plateau. So this is called Haiti. And it begins and ends with actual quotes from that trip. Epidemiologically, this area is terrifying. La Saline, the giant slum, on a sun-soaked, trash-soaked morning, as the children filled their buckets from a makeshift well. The pigs scavenged while a rat watched all. Why bother to hide? La Saline, somewhere nearby, the assaulted, salted sea. Days later, the last light high in the Central Plateau, so far, so bone-crushed by the road, I'd argued against going, Soto'o. They filled the benches and told us of death upon death. A man who'd lost his son said, I am a bird left without a branch to land on.
It's beautiful.
I remember that. It was one of the saddest things I'd ever heard in my life when he said that.
You wrote another poem that caught my eye, because it kind of takes you behind the curtain here, what we do, what you and I do, and you kind of gave a little bit away about the art of the interview.
Especially
when things don't go as planned.
Yeah. A lot on my mind was about what we do here every night. It's an interesting transaction, mm-hmm. right? There's somebody in our ear, the director talking, there's the communication with, and we know there are people out there watching.
Right.
So there's a lot going on. This is a little bit of a poem called The Art of the Interview. And it begins, engaged, open, curious, firm, prepared by all that's come before, no surprises, but ready to be surprised again. So it goes on from there about what happens in an interview. But then there's this thing that's happened to both of us, right? Once a man froze, unable to speak. I asked and answered every question myself, then said, you agree? We could have gone on that way forever. Another night, the lights went out. We understood we were still, again, always in the dark. You're laughing because it's happened to you.
It has happened to
somebody
me.
Somebody freezes, and what happens in that moment? The night the lights went out was actually, I was sitting over there with Mark and David doing the Friday politics. The power went out.
That's right, and you had to keep talking.
Keep talking.
Okay, one more. This is kind of personal because this also takes us a little bit inside your life, and you wrote a book about what happened after the passing of your, a poem about what happened after the passing of your father.
Yeah. Some of the poems in here are more personal, and this is one that, you know, everybody deals with the death of a loved one. And a lot of strange things happened at a moment like that, strange thoughts. This is on the day of my father's funeral, which was a year ago. It's called Succession. One morning, state police escort us to your grave. The next, my flight is canceled. Maintenance issues breaking out all over. You would speak of a grand theory, something tying all this together, but you had none yourself, none that reached me then or now, as I drive your car slowly into the tranquil streets of my youth. Here is where I learned to ride a bike on this high hill that is no hill at all, and still I fell. And now you descend, and still I fall. And here is where I learned to doubt in the chapel where we donned black skullcaps that meant nothing, I tell you. If God speaks, it is elsewhere. And here are my own children, rooted and uncertain, watching me speak to you. You watched the news every night, worried if I did not make air, traveling, sick, useless, lost. Now that you are gone, traffic parted by the state police, can I, too, disappear? It's a hard one to read, even sitting
it's
here,
because
my father would watch us every night. And if I wasn't there for a few days, he'd wonder, what happened? You know, where are you? And I'd have to explain.
And the loss of a parent's universal experience eventually.
Yeah.
I want to ask you one more question. As you put this book together, and as you just go through your life as a writer, a poet, a television personality, mm-hmm. Do you feel that you're constantly looking at the world through multiple lenses?
I do, and I like that. I like that so much. I think that's what the world is about. I love what we do, you know, looking at the world through facts, and we're so careful every night to try to get it right. But I think the world is filled with all kinds of other things, art and music, and I want that in my life. I want that to be part of our program. That's why I care about it so much. I think that's what's happening in our world. When we tell people every night, here's what happened today, I want it to be what they expect, but I also want to bring some of this. I want it in my life.
Well, we all want it, and that's why we're so glad you've written this book, The News Poems. Jeffrey Brown, thank you.
Thank you, Gwen.